Thank you everyone for coming to today to this very wonderful occasion of a ceremony of transmission. It's a very special day because two of our very wonderful Dharma brothers will have this ceremony after many years of work and practice. Bodhidharma said, transmission not dependent on words and speech, transmission from mind to mind. Kwang Zen Master said, every day is a good day. Sun Zen Master said, open your mouth already mistake. Then is Kwang's speech a mistake? Long ago, Buddha said, under the Bodhi tree, only don't know 6 years, what am I? Saw a star, got enlightened, got star transmission. Is that mind to mind? If you have mind, you can get transmission. If you have no mind, then what? Long ago in Yongsan Mountain, Shakyamuni Buddha held up a flower. No one understood. Only Mahakashapa smiled. Then Buddha said, my true Dharma transmission I give to Mahakashapa. That's the beginning of our school family tradition. That tradition was continued on and passed to China through Bodhidharma. And then from, of course, Bodhidharma to the sixth patriarch. At the sixth patriarch's, after the sixth patriarch's time, five schools appeared. Rinchi school, Soto school, Dong'an school, Unmun school, Koban school, and Mian school. Our family tradition is Rinchi line. But in Korea, during the time of the second patriarch, already transmission was taken to Korea, and Korea's family line began. After the sixth patriarch's time, during the second patriarch's time, nine mountain schools went to Korea from China. That's before sixth patriarch's time. But this line got a little mixed up and a little lost and not clear. So during after the sixth patriarch's time, Tego Sansa, who already got transmission in Korea, saw something was not clear, returned to China and got transmission again in the Chinese line, which was a very clear line, which we have on our wall. But what is transmission? Today, two of our older Dharma brothers have kept with our tradition of don't know. We follow Buddha's way and Bodhidharma's family tradition and Lin Shi's line, and also our family from Doksun San Mountain, and this our teachers only don't know teaching. Mangong Zen Master said the whole world is a single flower. When he gave transmission to Kwang Zen Master, our grand teacher, he wrote a poem. The ancient Buddha never gave transmission. How can I give transmission to you? The cloud disappears. The moon by itself is bright. Sun San is Kwang. When Kwang Zen Master gave transmission to Sun San Sin, he said, I am the flower, you are the bee. Zen Master Sun San has pollinated many human beings' minds throughout the world. And today we have a transmission ceremony. Because it's been over for quite a few years, that our two Dharma brothers, Perl and Shrobe Jita Boksanin, have only practiced our one way. It's been 6 years since they've got had the Inca ceremony and acknowledgement of some attainment. It's been 3 years after that they visited many Zen masters throughout this country and tried other traditions. So today, the fruit is ripe. This fruit is a very wonderful fruit because inside it holds the seed of a clear world and a new world. So I made a poem for you. There is the bright sun in the sky. Many guests have already appeared. Empty hands complete no hindrance. Two bright faces shining in 10 directions. Thank you very much.
Bosa, 5 minutes meditation.
Wu Bong, Kwang Zen Master. Muyu Sonakshinyo, Jingbong Myoyu Songira, Hao Yaban Myongigo, Wu Bong Bang Myongolira, 대유년 8월 1일 덕승산인 승산선.
Kwang School Zen, Zen Master Sung San, founding teacher. Certificate of transmission. Wu Bong, transmission name. Bok Mu, Dharma name. Jacob Perl, original name. Kwang says, doesn't have good and bad mind. True emptiness is mystical nature. Why does the crow call at midnight? Bright moon shines on universal peak. Signed, Sing San, Land of Duksan Mountain, Sing San, August 1st, 1993.
So, your Dharma name is Wu Bong. Wu Bong Zen Master. Wu means universal. Bong means high peak. Universal high peak. What does it mean? More.
Kwang School of Zen, Zen Master Sung San, founding teacher. Certificate of transmission. Wu Guang, transmission name. Wan Un, Dharma name. Richard Shrobe, original name. Kwang said, in the mountains, a bird sings chi chi chi. Great river waters flow. Where do 10,000 dharmas return? Universal light fill heaven and earth. Sung San, land of Duksan Mountain, August 1st, 1993.
Your name is Wu Bang. Wu is the universe. Kwang is the light. Universal light. What is the universal light?
You already understand.
I know.
Through the skylight, there is bright on your head.
Oh, headache, I get it. Soaring Gapong means soaring means Dharma cave is soaring. Dharma mountain. In China, soaring sa, soaring temple. Behind the soaring cave, Bodhidharma stayed now for 9 years. So Gapong is tradition. Dharma, Bodhidharma tradition. So soaring Gapong. Okay? Very good.
See this?
then this stick, the sound and your mind, are they same or different? Listen, in the corner, the fan. An eminent teacher said, the gate of Zen is very wide, very easy. Our teacher says, put down only your idea and your opinion, then become complete. But put down your idea and your opinion does not mean that you must lose your eyes. So I have two stories. Once a monk went to do a retreat, a solo retreat, then in the middle of the retreat, nighttime, great bodhisattva appeared, then said, you are great monk, you have special power, tomorrow you must go to nearby ledge, only believe, only trust, then you jump and you will fly in the air. Next morning this monk went to the ledge, jumped and died. Another monk one day was stirring rice, cooking rice for all the monks in the temple, stirring in a big pot. Then that time, in the steam, great bodhisattva appeared, then said to him, you are a great monk, very special. Then this monk took the stick, then shouted, why do you seem dirty? The monk's soup! Then I...
Do you have another battery? Yes.
Then became great Zen master. Lose your eyes, then lose your life. Get true eyes, get everything. So let's consider, what is this true eye? So, carefully watch. Long ago, Buddha told Shariputra, no eyes. So you must lose your eyes, have no eyes. But if you have no eyes, how do you get true eye? Our honored guest here says, your eyes are always eating. Eating eyes? What kind of eating? I don't understand. Maybe eating form, maybe eating color, then how do they digest? What kind of eye is that? At a talk, once a great Zen master pointed to his Zen stick and said, this stick has special eyes. They can see through everything. See into your mind. Maybe that's the true eye. But what kind of eye is that? Many, many ideas, but just now, how do you get this true eye? Ha! Please look, the stick is brown.
Thank you very much. Maybe amnesia or something. Empty sky makes full moon. Full moon makes empty sky. Sky never made full moon. Full moon never made empty sky. Full moon shining brightly, empty sky black like ink. Which one is the correct statement? Ha! Wake up! Why all this talk about moon and sky? The sun is hot as hell outside this morning. About 9 years ago, after De Sun Sanim certified me to be a teacher, I went around leading retreats at various Zen centers and giving talks. And many times this question would appear. Could you please say something about Zen and psychotherapy? Sometimes that question would even appear in the middle of 3-day Yongnyo Junjin when we were having the Dharma speech. I always thought, that's an odd question. And I wondered whether people were just indulging their conceptual minds with comparisons. But later I began to realize that in some way, people were probably asking, what is the role of emotions, imagination, and even fantasy in our Zen practice? So there's a famous story, one of the Kwangans in the Mumang Fan. It says, a monk that came to call on Popam Zen Master before a ceremony. Popam pointed to the bamboo blinds, and two monks simultaneously stood up and rolled up the blinds. Then Popam said, one has got it, one has lost it. You have to understand, when it says a monk came to call on Popam, it doesn't mean he just came for tea casually. That's an expression that you see in all the biographies of Zen masters, that they, when they were monks, they traveled around many, many hundreds of miles calling on different teachers. So when it says he came to call on Popam, he probably had traveled a long way and was looking for instruction. And Popam pointed to the blinds. So maybe this monk thought, oh, Buddha raised up a flower. Muji Zen Master raised up one finger. This Zen Master pointed. Then simultaneously, two monks got up and rolled up the blinds. Then Popam said, one has got it, one has lost it. This monk at that time probably had a big headache and a big question. And I'm sure if he sincerely stayed with his great question about that, at some point he had a moment of just seeing, or just hearing, or just offering food to someone, or just saying, can I help you? And at that moment, his experience surely transcended getting and losing. But to transcend getting and losing does not mean to be without getting and losing, or without gain and loss. So if you look at this Kwang from another aspect, you could say that all the characters in this little drama are all our own mind. The pointing, the getting up, the rolling up the blinds, and the simultaneous emergence of gain and loss. So when you get up off your behind to move towards something, you've lost something. And when you roll up the blinds, you've also lost something. There's something quite comforting about darkness. As we all know, in the early morning when the bell rings for meditation. So it's not without giving up something or losing something that we enter into this life of Zen practice. Someone in New York told me a story. So when they were a young boy in grammar school, they changed schools. And probably they were maybe in sixth grade. And they were seated at a table, I guess the kids in this school were seated at tables at the time, with two girls. It was a man telling me the story. And he said, one girl was very, very pretty, and he was attracted to her. And the other one was not so pretty, and he liked both of them. And then the school dance came, and this was still at that time in history when boys asked girls to dance, and girls did not ask boys to dance. And he said that he asked the less pretty girl to dance. And when he told me this story, he put it in the context of his not having gone for what he really wanted. But I saw it as something much more complex than that, and that in some way, because he said he felt for the less pretty girl, and he felt if he had asked the more pretty girl, he would have hurt the feelings and disappointed the less pretty girl. And so I think in our phenomenal existence, we are always forced to make some choices. And those choices are not without gaining something and losing something. And that's a very important point just to bear in mind. Talking about the role of emotions and fantasy and imagination in Zen practice, there's a poem by Desonsene in the poem book that we have called The Bone of Space. A while ago I got very interested in this poem, so I'm going to read it twice. The first time I'm just going to read the poem so you'll get a feel of what it is. But the second time I'm going to make a little commentary on this poem. You know, in the old Zen literature there's two kinds of commentaries. Someone presents something and then someone gives a long commentary afterwards, like a Dharma speech. Second kind of commentary is more like after a line or a sentence is like a little parenthesis, and some statement is inserted, you know, or it's more like heckling. It's like when the Brooklyn Dodgers were in Brooklyn many years ago, before they moved to Los Angeles, Brooklyn Dodgers fans used to call them the bums, you know? And so they used to sit in the bleachers and yell, "Go bums!" So in the Zen literature, there's similar kinds of statements. Someone was saying, "Well, he showed his gallbladder. How regrettable!" <That's a compliment. laughs> So, De Sun Sing's poem says, "Looking over Southern Mountain, I clap my hands. Cumulus clouds transform into dog, tiger, man, and Buddha, then disperse, and to my sorrow disappear in a rush of wind over the mountain's edge, leaving the sky blue, tree green." So here comes the second version. They essentially warned us about this, by the way. When his book, Whole World is a Single Flower, came out, we had these little commentaries on his poems. He said, "I made little commentary, but in the future, you all will add more and more commentary." And a few weeks ago in New York, I remembered this Yiddish expression that my mother and father used to use. It's kochleffel. It means literally a cooking spoon. It means like you can't leave the soup alone. You have to stir it. So I couldn't leave this alone either. So, looking over Southern Mountain, which way did you say? I clap my hands. Oh, there's some magic there. Cumulus clouds transform into dog, tiger, man, Buddha, then disperse. So soon, where did they go? And to my sorrow, disappear over the mountain's edge in a rush of wind. How sad, how sad. Gee, jolly, go sad, gee, jolly, go sad. Leaving the sky blue, the tree green. Thank you for the teaching. If you hadn't told me, I wouldn't have known. Today, two new Zen masters appear. Which one has got it? Which one has lost it? Ha! You please add in the last line.
Congratulatory talks. I would like to invite Venerable Mahavisananda.
Happy birthday to you, Jacob, and what is his name?
Preacher.
You born Zen Master.
Now congratulatory talk by Zen Master Wu Bong.
But I want to really offer my heartfelt congratulations to our two Zen masters.
it was in the bottom of my heart to congratulate both. And
also to congratulate our Sangha. I think it goes without saying that this couldn't happen without this, and this couldn't happen without this, and this couldn't happen without this, and so forth and so on. Today is really a wonderful day. And also, for me, this ceremony is a ceremony in a way of our commitment, each one of us, to continue in practice. I think it perhaps is very easy to think that because someone gets a new title, or a new robe, or a new whisk, that somehow this might be some resting place. Our practice is that there really is no resting place, and I can assure you from the inside that when you are congratulated or you get a title for not having anything, you get something in a hurry and get a whole new practice again. So today really is, in a sense, an appreciation day of ongoing practice. It is an appreciation of all those who have come before us, who have brought this practice here, our teacher, Desansanin, Kobang, Mangang, and countless people into the past, and countless people who will follow us and follow the example that we're setting now in our practice. So congratulations to all of you, really, on this wonderful day. And congratulations again to Richard and Jacob for their really wonderful effort over many, many years.
I congratulate Richard and Jacob also. I have known both for a long time, especially Jacob. When I first came to the Zen Center, in the very beginning, when Sansa first came to this country, I first saw Sansa's name, and then I saw Jacob, and their old, familiar faces. And it's been wonderful to be with them through all these years, and it's nice to celebrate this. I want to congratulate the Sangha also. I'm just so impressed with how genuinely happy people feel for us when something happens like this. I never had a chance after my ceremony, thank you. I never felt so much support. It was just great. And I feel that again today. And I thought of an image of what that was like. And I'm a visiting nurse, and our hospice has a little bit of equipment. And once in a while, somebody will donate a new piece of equipment to us. And as nurses, there's this one thing that we like to get them. We've gotten a couple of them. It's this reclining chair that really very comfortable, and then it's electric, and then it can recline the patient all the way up, so when they're too weak to stand, it gets them way up, and then they can kind of get going because they don't have the strength to get up from a regular sitting position. And it's like we are so happy when someone gives us that because we know our patients so well, and so we go, oh, this is really going to make their life easier. And so it's kind of that unconditional love of it's not for you, it's going to make somebody else's life easier. And I think that if any of us can find our seed and our way of making someone's life easier, then that's the best feeling in the world. And so feeling support from them and also being able to give them support. And thank you for your wonderful faculty and everything. It's been great.
Thank you very much, Zen Masters. Now please stand up for the great full great vows.
Vows save them all. Actions are endless. We vow to extinguish them all. The teachings are infinite. We vow to learn them all. The Buddha way is inconceivable. We vow to attain it.
Please be seated.
So then Mata Hachim. So, for five, Zen Master we have. It's consciousness, contemplation, it's consciousness. Too many new consciousness. consciousness means human beings many killed animals. So animal consciousness become human beings. So when you look at the old human beings, many humans, dog action, cat action, lion action, not human being action, that's animal action. Long time, 1,000 years ago, much better. No, getting bad. That name is end of this world. End of this. Russia, America, they had direction. Common direction, capitalism direction.
Congratulations.
Do you want to go watch?